In this lecture, we'll be answering the question, what is evolution, or what is evolutionary biology? We'll start off first with a brief overview about different areas of interest to evolutionary biologists. The general goal of this is for students to just become familiar with broad areas of evolutionary research and what types of questions evolutionary biologists investigate. More specifically, after this and the next lecture, you should be able to differentiate different types of evolutionary research and what they are focusing on and what their purpose is. For example, phylogenetics, paleontology, or the evolution of different types of traits or phenotypes. So we're going to start off with a question from Mr. Darwin here. I'm always curious, what things do students associate with the word evolution? When you hear the word evolution, either in the media or in conversation or posed by a professor in biology class, what do you associate with evolution? And go ahead and take a minute to think, and I would encourage you to actually write down some of your thoughts here. Go ahead and pause the video if you want and just brainstorm. When you hear, or when you hear me say evolution, what do you associate with that? So evolutionary biologists are interested in a large number of things, and evolutionary biologists work closely with a lot of similar disciplines. And often people might call themselves an evolutionary biologist, but they also might call themselves something else, like a paleontologist or an evolutionary ecologist or an ecologist, an anthropologist. So here I want to go over some of the major themes and types of questions that evolutionary biologists are investigated in. One big question is, of course, where did life begin? How did life even get started? For example, did life originate as RNA or DNA? Most people think now it's RNA. And also, where on Earth or in what environment or what ecological conditions did life originate? Many people have proposed that in conditions such as deep sea vents or hydrothermal vents, perhaps that is where life originated. Well, this is a really interesting question. It's not always very easy to pursue this experimentally, and most people who work as evolutionary biologists don't work in this field, though a similar field or related field to evolutionary biology, astrobiology, considers the question from a different angle, which is how might life have emerged on other planets? Once we have the origin of life, we often consider how life evolved and changed over time, or the evolutionary history of life. So once we had conditions to create our first organisms or our first cells, whether they were RNA-based or DNA-based, once we had single-celled life, how did organisms change over time? How did they develop the ability to photosynthesize? How did eukaryotes with membrane-bound organelles develop? How did multicellular life develop? And then how did all of the diversity, all the many types of animals, multicellular complex animals we have, and multicellular complex plants and other organisms evolve over time? So what is the broad evolutionary history of life? Again, this is a field that's not necessarily that open to experimentation. And most people who call themselves evolutionary biologists don't work necessarily on this question, though it's always an interesting question to consider. And there's always new research coming out, especially as we gain more understanding of genomes and the ability to understand how different genes function and where they may have originated deep in the history of life. Another big consideration of evolutionary biologists, and this is a field that is quite large and many people are engaged in, is what is the role of the fossil record in understanding the history of life and in understanding the evolution of life? So this includes paleontologists and to some extent archaeologists once we get, and anthropologists once we get to the history of humans. So once we have multicellular life, once we start having animals, we can start to develop fossils, and we can use that to piece together our understanding of how life changed over time and what are the origins of the organisms that are alive now. A major tool used by many evolutionary biologists, also by many ecologists, is phylogenetics. This is the tools and techniques and area of study to understand the relationships of organisms, often focusing on organisms that are alive today, such as primates, but also often trying to understand their relationship to extinct organisms or theoretical common ancestors that existed in the past. A key question that is considered often when we use phylogenetics is how did groups of organisms evolve, or how does the process of cladogenesis occur? So a clade is a distinct group of organisms that are evolutionary related. For example, we can consider how in the history of the evolution of primates did the group of great apes evolve, which includes gibbons and orangutans, gorillas, chimps, and ourselves. We're a coherent evolutionary group that shares numerous interesting traits. How did we split off as a group and then diversify from other primates? Similar to the topic of cladogenesis, and one which is many biologists are engaged on, is the study of speciation. So how did individual populations change over time or split off into different groups? For example, there are several species that are considered great apes. And how did, for example, very similar organisms that are still considered to be separate species, such as chimpanzees and bonobos, how did they split off and change so that they no longer interbreed? Another consideration that many evolutionary biologists work on is what is the origin of novel traits or novelties, phenotypes that are new to a group of organisms. Often we consider them as something that is typical or indicative of an organism, like the orange fur of an orangutan, or especially interesting are traits that allow organisms to survive better or do better than other organisms. Similar to the emergence of novel traits or things, by novel traits I mean things that didn't formerly exist within an evolutionary lineage or didn't exist at all. We'll talk more about that in the next lecture. Similar, related to this, is the topic of trait evolution. So once a trait evolves, how does it change over time within a species or between species? For example, all vertebrates have complex nervous systems, and primates have very sophisticated nervous systems and abilities to communicate, to take in visual and auditory information, communicate vocally. But there is a large difference between the cognitive abilities of monkeys, great apes, and especially humans. So this phylogeny here, underneath some of the names, it says EC. This stands for encephalization quotient. It's basically the relative size of the brain, taking into account the size of the organisms. So monkeys, gorillas, and chimps all have EC values that are 2.2 or less. So all of these organisms have a similar ratio between the size of their brain and the rest of their body. Humans, however, have a very large encephalization quotient, an EC of 7.4. This is indicative of our very large brains relative to our bodies. And this correlates with our capacity for language, for communication, for being able to communicate vocally, build sophisticated tools, etc. So all of these organisms, from monkeys on up to humans, have brains, have sophisticated nervous systems, but in humans, this trait has evolved and changed to become very sophisticated. So evolutionary biologists often study how a single trait, like a brain or a nervous system, can change between organisms or change over time. Another consideration that many evolutionary biologists and many evolutionary ecologists are interested in is how traits vary within a species. So most of the great apes are dark colored. So gorillas, chimpanzees, bonobos, most gibbons have black fur. Humans don't have fur. We have hair on our heads and other parts of our bodies, but it's very much less sparse. And we also have skin color that varies considerably from light to dark. This is a trait that has several adaptive reasons for it, related to vitamin D and cancer prevention. So what caused this trait to evolve? Why does it vary so much within humans? How did it change over time from our ancestors? Unifying most of these considerations, and something many evolutionary biologists study, is what is the genetic basis for different traits? How do different species vary genetically or genomically? What is the genetic basis? What are the genes that underlie new traits? What genes have changed as traits evolved? Or what genes are different, what alleles are different that drive variation? For example, it's often quoted that around 15 or 20 different genes are involved in human skin color. Each one of them has different alleles, and the combination of all of those alleles and on all those different genes results in the broad variation of skin color. So many evolutionary biologists want to know genetically what leads to variation in traits or the evolution of traits.